How is everyone? Welcome to the video. I almost feel unworthy to make a video because I know that there are those out there who are ready for, you know, the next step, the next step, the next wow. As we walk together in the wow, what is the next wow? I mean, we have pushed the envelope here to an extraordinary extent, and I'm thinking, well, what's next? There has to be something next, right? That may be go beyond concepts and words. I don't know what more I can do in terms of concepts and words to take the next step. So this is where I'm at. I'm saying, wow, you know, we all need to impress ourselves ultimately so we can finally feel good enough about ourselves to set down this ridiculous pretense we've been engaged in, time, space, process, and form, which is all a pretense. And so we do need to impress ourselves. And if you looking at your life, you will realize that everything you've done is an attempt to impress yourself in some way. And those who have done a lot of this have gotten up to a point where they're entertaining, you know, tremendous clarity, and this producing, you know, this is very impressive. It is. But once you've done that, you know, then what? You know, I'm trying to think today, what can I do that is truly impressive, that impresses me? I said, wow, this is a tough one. All I can think of is, you know, the vision of oneness, the vision that shift the perception and see God as the world. Only that can impress me at this point, really, pretty much so. The Holy Spirit's done a great job in my life to bring me into situations where I could examine my valuing of the world and see, does this really impress me? Am I really impressed by this? Or do I need something else, actually? And I realize, hey, I need something else. This is not actually, doesn't really impress me. And so I've realized that my entire life has been focused on that. How do I truly impress myself? And still not truly impressed. And therefore, I know very well that these videos do not truly impress you, but they, just like in my life, we take steps, and we are temporarily, wow, this is temporarily impressive, but then the wow wears off, and we say, well, I'm not really truly impressed. I know there's another step. So these videos are steps, but you know, that ultimately we have to we need more steps. There's no question about it. There are some in the world who are ready for additional steps, and so far I have not been able to well, we're right at the point where that needs to happen, right at that point. And so I'm certainly focused on that. In the meantime, until that, whatever that is, I'm not sure. I mean, ultimately, sure, shift perception, see God as the world. I feel that would be truly impressive, something that really, really be impressive. And to abide in that, be really impressive. I've had glimpses of it, which were quite impressive. And yet, I realize that abiding in it would be much more impressive and maybe truly impressive. So how do we keep transitioning towards even greater and greater wowness? Well, composure. What we're learning here is spiritual composure. It's very, very important. Ultimately, all teaching on this planet, this world, we give it a different purpose, which is spiritual reorientation. Spiritual reorientation. We have projected this world as spirit mind, projected this world as an attempt to deceive God, actually, to make God lesser than what God is, so that we can feel that, hey, we're better than God because God's lesser. And we're trying to deceive God with time, space, process, and form. And this is the purpose that we have imagined this world and bodies and time, space, process, and form for. This is why we've done it. now, but we can give it a different purpose. And by the way, we've had faith. The whole situation is faith-based. Hallucination is faith-based, actually. You want to see something. You want to believe that there's a way to deceive God and lower God down, make God less. So you believe you see it. You have faith that it's there. You have faith that it's there because you want it to be there. You have faith that it's there. So we have faith in that time, space, process, and form are real. We have faith in that. So this is why we are perceiving the world. Perception actually is faith, entirely faith-based, entirely faith-based. In reality, there's no such thing as perception. We have immediate, total knowing. Not intellectual knowing, but absolute knowing, which is non-dual, completely non-dual. Perception is faith-based entirely. So we have been engaged in this massive exercise of faith. And we're too scared to simply set faith down entirely, immediately, right now. This is called the continuity fear. So what we need to do is give a different purpose to faith, which ultimately means give a different purpose to this world. So what we do is we flip the script of faith, we flip it and give it a positive usage, which is what? Walking together in the wow. Spiritual reorientation, really. Spiritual reorientation, which means to practice remembrance of truth, which really means to realize that all this is simply a pretense. We're pretending all of this. We're imagining it all. So the right use of this world is spiritual, to use in time, space, process, and form. The right use of this faith-based imagination is to spiritual reorientation. This is the right use. So we don't have to reject the world. We can give it a different purpose. We don't have to reject perception. We can give it a different purpose. We don't have to reject faith. We can give it a different purpose. And once it has served that purpose perfectly and fully, then at that point we can set it down and we're ready for, you know, immaculate, perfect knowingness of reality. But that is beyond the scope of our aims here, because we cannot stay in a dream with this perfect knowingness, okay? Cannot. So we are aiming at spiritual reorientation, which is giving the world a new purpose, giving our lives a new purpose, and giving faith a new purpose. And this is the whole purpose of what we call quote-unquote religion. That's the entire purpose, is spiritual reorientation. Now, we may, because we are so derelict, so confused about our pretensions, we have a hard time, difficult time with spiritual reorientation, and we'd make a lot of silly mistakes, okay? But let's not blame the divine purpose of spiritual reorientation. Let us not castigate that because of our silly mistakes, which we've made quite a few of them, to say the least. Misinterpreting, you know, what we're being told. We're being told yes, and we interpret it as no. You know, we're being told this is impossible, and we interpret that this is possible. And so we struggle. We struggle. But in no way can we estrange ourselves from God. In no way can we estrange ourselves from being included in this spiritual reorientation program, which will continue on until everyone has finally succeeded in recognizing the pretension that we've been engaged in and being rehabilitated to the point where they're able to set it down without any fear. The spiritual reorientation program will continue until all are saved, every single one, without exception. Now, this may seem like it may take a long time, but we'd be surprised at the leverage and momentum that this can gain. And so it may not take as long as we suspect. As you look at the world right now, there are quite a few folks in this world who are thumbing their noses at spiritual reorientation. In fact, they want the whole planet to be a planet that thumbs its nose at spiritual reorientation, and they're doing everything they can to make sure that happens. And you might think, wow, you know, how can they can possibly be reoriented spiritually? And you'd be surprised, because the bed that they're making is a very uncomfortable bed, and their lack of sleep in that bed, you know, is eventually will drive them to say, wow, help. I really can't take any more of this. And then the spiritual reorientation actually goes much quicker than you would expect, no matter how derelict those who start out. Remember, Jesus came, said he came to save not the righteous, but the sinners, meaning those who needed spiritual reorientation. That's what he came here for. That's what this program is for. It's a divine program that encompasses many, many, many different teachers, many, many different approaches, etc. But it's all basically the same purpose, which is spiritual reorientation, to ultimately recognize that all of this is mere pretense, an idle wish, and mere pretense. And we set it down with a laugh, and that's it. So there have been, quite a few. There are quite a few teachers involved with that. In fact, we may even be some of those teachers ourselves. At some point, no doubt, we will be. And it's we're all pulling in the same direction ultimately, even though different times, places, cultures, et cetera, it may appear to be there's lots of variation in it, Of course, that's expected because there's lots of variation in pretense. And you have to help people where they're at. They got to start somewhere, right? You got to start, and so you have to meet them kind of halfway, to get them started. As an analogy in Buddhism, is that something is said about there's some like children in a burning house, and the children are so absorbed in their playing, a little imaginary mind playing, they're playing with their little dolls or whatever they're doing, that they don't even get out of the house. They don't leave the burning house. So I believe it was something in the Buddhist teachings talks about how they sort of are tricked, as it were, where they're promised this, beautiful chariot or beautiful vehicle outside of the house. They come out here, it's this, and they say, oh, wow, okay, and they go running outside of the house, and then they're saved from the burning house. But the beautiful chariots that are out there are not the ultimate goal, okay? They're used to at least get you out of the burning house. And this is a very wise, this displays great wisdom. A lot of the confusion in religion has to do with this issue, in saying, oh, wait a minute, what's going on here? Well, healed perception is like this beautiful chariot vehicle, beautiful car, we'd say today, and it gets us out of this burning house of self-delusion, severe suffering and misery. But that's not the ultimate goal, okay? But it is a necessary goal. It's an intermediate step, as Jesus puts it, it's an intermediate step. Healed perception is an intermediate step. It's still not knowing, but that's fine, because it's easy to go from healed perception to knowing, to relinquish perception altogether. Once perception is healed, it's easy to relinquish perception. It's unhealed perception that is extremely difficult to relinquish because of the massive continuity fear. Now let's put it this way. Let us say that we're on this wide open plane, and there's two people, and one of them is in a very whimsical mood. And they have this sort of whim, like, hey, I want to play this game that I'm being chased by some terrible destructive force that wants to kill me. And so they look at the other friend, they're two friends, and they suddenly see their friend as some terrible destructive force that wants to annihilate them. And they say, oh my gosh, where do I go? And this is all just a game. They decided to have this whimsical game. So they start running. But it's on this level plane. And there's nowhere to hide. There's no boulders, no nothing. It's just this level plane. And they look back and they say, uh-oh, they can still see me. They know where I am. Oh my gosh, because they know where I am, they'll be able to find me and annihilate me. And so the one that's running away playing this game, who decided to play this game. Keep in mind, the other friend didn't decide to play this game. They're saying, my friend has decided to play a silly, whimsical game. Here we go again, what can I do? So the one is running away, says, wow. And they start getting extremely scared. And they say, I can't hide. I can't hide from this terrible, destructive force that's out to destroy me. And then suddenly an idea comes into their mind, you know, and they say, oh, wait a minute, there is a way. There is a way. And so they stop. They stop running. And then they start hallucinating, actually. They start imagining, and they say, oh my gosh, how fortunate. I was running on this plane without anywhere to hide, and now suddenly I see right in front of me, there's this massive dark pit. Wow, how fortunate. And then they say, oh, and I'm seeing myself. I'm now going to the edge of the pit, and now I'm starting to climb down in the pit. And now I'm climbing down in the pit, and I'm going down in this dark pit, and I'm going further and further and deeper and deeper. And the more I go, the darker it gets. And whoops, I slipped, and I'm falling down in this pit, and I'm falling, 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 falling. And the more I fall, the more incredibly dark it becomes. And then they say, wow. Oh, isn't this amazingly fortuitous? I found this great hiding place from this terrible being that is out to destroy me. And they say, oh, this is such a blessing. This is great. And they say, you know what? It's so dark. I don't even know where I am. I don't even know where this place is. It's such an incredible hiding place. Nobody knows where this place is. This is incredibly fortunate, they say. And yet then they still have this nagging feeling like, you know, like maybe, you know, I don't feel quite safe yet. I don't feel quite safe. Of course, because they're actually standing still in wide open light there on this plane in full sight, you know, of their friend. And they're hallucinating, actually. So they're thinking, you know, I'm not quite safe yet. And so then something starts to happen, and they're adding another layer of hallucination to what's going on, okay? So they're dreaming this. This is a dream. And they say, oh my gosh, I hear this shaking and roaring. What is this? Oh, it's a cave-in. It's a cave-in. And all of this deep, deep, massive pit is now caving in, and it's filling in with dense, dense, heavy granite and rock, you know, like cement, as it were, you know, just heavy, heavy, heavy. And the whole cave, the whole deep pit is now filled up, plugged up with most incredibly heavy and dense material. And here you are at the bottom of this pit now. And fortunately, you say, well, fortunate that I have this tiny little crevice here that I'm jammed into, that I didn't get crushed by this plug-in. And yet the whole, all the rest of the pit is completely now full, packed full of this most dense and heavy material imaginable. And so you're saying, oh, this is great. I can never be found now. No way can I be found. This one that wants to annihilate me, they could have gone down in the pit after me, right? But now the pit is all plugged up. No way. No way. So you're thinking, hey, this is great. What a fortunate place. What a fortunate place of safety I have found. You know, pitch dark. You know, you're all isolated, all alone in this place now. No way to get out whatsoever, right? And you say, and you go, whew, you know, finally got rid of that terrible evil tormentor that was after me. Meanwhile, your friend is just standing next to you, just saying, you want to stop hallucinating? Anytime, you know. Anytime, buddy. You know, I'm right here. No worries, no troubles. Whenever you want to stop dreaming, it's fine. Fine with me. You know, they're just waiting there, sitting, just standing next to you. Just standing next to you, waiting for you to, you know, come out of this ridiculous dream hallucination that you're engaging in. Meanwhile, you believe you're at the bottom of this bottomless pit, and this pit is completely plugged up, and you're wedged in this little crevice. Okay, and you're thinking that you're like super fortunate. And in fact, you feel so fortunate that you feel like you want to thank whoever did this, who saved you from annihilation. And you're thinking like, wow, you know, I was on the brink of annihilation, and now I'm completely saved and protected. This, who did this? Who did this for me? You're thinking. And you say, well, you know, I didn't do it. You know, I mean, it's just this incredible great good fortune. In fact, it's such great good fortune that it must have come from God. You know, only God could have put that great good fortune there for me. You know, of course. When in this situation, when you're hallucinating this out of great fear of annihilation, the last thing you're going to admit is that you're hallucinating it, right? Because that removes the whole defensiveness of it, that all the fear would return. So you can't admit that you're hallucinating it and feel free of this fear, you know. Of course, you could wake up, stop the silly game, and realize, of course, you're only pretending the whole thing in the first place. But we're not quite yet at that point, okay, in our narrative. So you say, wow, I can't admit that I'm hallucinating. In fact, I can't even think that it's possible. So I certainly didn't do this, is what we say. I certainly didn't do this. So in other words, we want to keep this situation. He said, wow, this is such a great situation. I want to make sure that it stays this way, and I kind of feel like I'm a little insecure because, I don't know, even though I'm buried in this deep pit, it's all plugged up, I still feel like maybe someone could dig down through that, you know, and find me down here. So I still feel a little insecure. So you say, wait a minute now, if I could just like get a protector of this pit, you know, a protector, that one that loves this pit so much that they wouldn't allow anyone to dig down in this pit, who feels so protective towards me that they won't allow anyone, that this terrible force that wants to annihilate me, that won't allow them to ever dig down and find me. Now, who would that be? And they say, well, I want a protector that has the power to protect me, so I'm going to... And then, oh, there is a protector. Wow, how fortunate again. And this protector is quote-unquote God, little g. Okay, little g, all right. So, okay, there's this God that loves me so much that they will never, that their whole purpose is to protect me and make sure that I'm never found here by that terrible, terrible destructive force that wants to annihilate me. And that this God has the power to prevent that destructive force from ever, 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 ever finding me, ever. And you say, wow, that completes my safety. I'm so safe now. I'm so safe now. And then you kind of later on, you sort of start thinking a little bit, and you still feel, it's kind of weird, but I still feel a little vulnerable here for some reason. I don't know what it could possibly be. You know, it can't possibly be that I'm just imagining all this, and I decided to play this completely whimsical game with my good friend, my dear friend. No, that can't be it. So it must be, what is it? And then you say, oh, that this God that is protecting your hiding place is not entirely reliable, or that this God is kind of like getting kind of upset with me for some reason, and I need to do something about that. So, what do I do? Well, I need to start praying to this God and say, "What can I do, God, to assuage your anger at me? I can feel that you're kind of not completely reliable in terms of protecting me, and that must mean, therefore, that you must be a little upset with me. It can't be that you're just a figment of my imagination, along with this cave, this pluggedness, this plugged pit. No, that can't be it. You must be real, but I feel like somehow you might like wander off, and you're not eternally committed to me, you know, to my protecting me. So what can I do to get you eternally committed to me?" And so you think, oh, I know what it is. That God's kind of upset with me, angry because I did something wrong, you know, like I'm not crammed in this crack in the right position. Let me reposition myself here. Okay, this, oh yeah, that does it. God's very pleased at that. And then later on, you still feel God. Oh, God, this doesn't feel eternally committed to me. So God must be angry with me. It's not that I. It must be it. And then it's okay. Okay, what do I do? Okay, I need to change position a little bit here and put that and say, oh, okay. And then they say, okay, God's happy now. Whew. I'm nervous. And then later on, we'll feel again, still feeling like this. There's something a little bit flimsy about this God. You know, you can't really put your finger on what it is. So you think, well, maybe God doesn't, you know, I need to like this. You know, okay, God, I'm happy like this. And then, and say, oh, yeah, okay, that's it. But, you know, continues on. So you start thinking, geez, this is really scaring me. I need to do something that shows I'm more committed to this God. Maybe I lack commitment to this God, you know? So what do I do? So you're there and you say, maybe I'm going to hit myself. Ouch. So, okay, good. I wanted to show God how I'm so committed that I'm willing to cause myself pain to show how committed I am. And then they say, okay, good. And then later on, you still feel, you know, just this God, it seems a little flimsy. So you, hurt myself again. Wow. And so you start causing yourself all sorts of pain and misery and suffering. And then you make a little clay figurine of yourself. You say, hey, I got an idea. Because it still isn't really, I still feel that this God's commitment is somehow a little flimsy. For some reason, what could it possibly be? Couldn't possibly be that we're hallucinating that. Could it be that? No. Because then that means that all this could be hallucination. And then that terrible, wrathful friend that wants to annihilate me, you know, it's going to get me. So, no, this is all real, but it's still flimsy. So okay, I got an idea, and so we start scraping together the wall, you know, the rock, and we make some dust. We get a bunch of dust off of this wall. So, okay, we scrape together a little pile of dust, and then we spit on the dust, you know, make it into a little ball of clay, and then we start making a little figurine out of this clay. We make a little body out of the clay, a little body, and then we say, God, look what I did. You know, do you like this? And we think, hey, I have an idea. Like maybe. Okay. And they said, look, watch this. And then what do you do? You squish the clay. Yeah, kill the figurine. Squish, annihilate the figurine. And then you say, wow, God loves that. You know, I feel like this is it. I achieved safety somehow, because like that somehow I brought the principle of annihilation in here. That seemed to really take a lot of fear off my mind, that somehow God says, oh yeah, this seems to work. Okay, let's just put it that way. It seems to work. I'm not going to explain the details of why it works at this point, because we're sort of involved in this narrative. And then make another clay little figurine, you know, squish that. That seems to help out too. And so you actually start making more and more little dust and figurines and everything, and squashing them. And you say, hey, this really seems to give me hope here that God really loves this. God loves this. And so on and so forth. You get the drift here. You get the drift of what's going on. So the question is, do I want to explain in more detail, or is it enough to get the drift? I think it's enough to get the drift, because you certainly, spiritually, intuitively, you say, ah, okay, yeah. After we've made all these clay figurines and have been squashing them for so long, you know, we still feel like it's still flimsy. And we say, wow, this is really, my gosh, I don't know what else to do. And then really you start getting scared. Because you say, you know what? Even this pit doesn't make me feel safe. And so I gotta go somewhere else. Even squashing these figurines doesn't make me feel safe. I gotta go somewhere else, actually, to feel safe. But then you say, well, how the heck do I get out of this pit then? You know, so I can go somewhere else. That's just, you start thinking, said, uh-oh, I got a problem here. I'm buried underneath, 100 miles of solid stone, trillion tons of stone. I mean, I am absolutely entombed down here. And then you say, hey, God, can you help me? And then we hear a response. We feel a response, and the response says, "Sure, no problem. I'll get you out of here." You think, "Is that you, God?" And there's no response to that exactly. And this assurance sort of communicates with us, relates to us, and says, "Don't worry. It's a piece of cake. I'll get you out of here, and it won't take long at all, actually. It's not as bad as you think." And you say, well, what do you mean? I say, that's great, but I'm buried underneath all this, I'm incarcerated under a million, trillion tons of rock here. And I can't even move. I'm weak. I can't, you say I can get out of here. It's easy. Wow, that's really amazing. I don't know. Now, you think this is coming from this God that protecting you in this pit all this time, But you're not sure. But you're certainly happy that you're getting this reassurance. You're certainly happy. You said, wow, this is really great reassurance. I thought I was doomed. But now I'm hearing that I can get out of this pit. So, where are we at now? This is called spiritual reorientation. You're actually beginning spiritual reorientation. Now, who is this? What is this? Where is this reorientation coming from? It's coming from God, the Holy Spirit. And is this God, the Holy Spirit, actually coming from this God that we have been believing that has been protecting us in this pit and sacrificing all these bodies? And that makes... No, it's not coming from that God at all. Because that God is a figment of our imagination, actually. But it's okay to believe it is coming from that God, okay? There's no worries about that. We don't have to stop believing in that God in order to get for the God, the Holy Spirit, to give us the right information. Because remember, our reality is that beautiful plane where everything is clear and with we love so much, and our friend is there with us, and all our friends are there actually. And that's our reality, and that is where God, that is our reality, etc. But we've forgotten that completely. We've forgotten, in fact, we're terrified of it. So we've imagined this other God is protecting us from all that. So we don't want to feel without any God at all, so to speak. And because we've forgotten the real true God and been believing in this imaginary God, we're not yet ready to say, hey, this God is a figment of my imagination, to try and keep myself safe down here. Because we'll then think, well, there is no God at all, and then we'll get, I can't be helped, freak us out. So like in that analogy of the children in the burning house, and then we show these nice chariots, say, come on out, and oh yeah, they're nice chariots, okay. We don't want to attack the idea of God as we see it in the world. Certainly those who are engaging in spiritual orientation initially are still clinging to this imaginary God that they've imagined to protect them from, imagined annihilation. So we certainly don't want to attack that and say that's wrong. We don't want to say it's wrong. Okay. So this is a sensitive area in spiritual reorientation, this is a sensitive area, very sensitive. And because of the sensitivity of this, it may seem historically that religion is kind of unsettled, you know. There's a lot of disputes and stuff. And like, it seems a little ragged. Yeah, it is a little ragged out of necessity. Because you cannot just go in there to someone who believes they're incarcerated under a trillion tons of stone in pitch darkness, who believes their only safety is sacrificing imaginary clay bodies to an imaginary god in order to appease the wrath of this imaginary god. You cannot just go in and tell them that their god that they've been believing in is imaginary and they need to stop imagining it entirely right now. Because that'll leave them feeling like they're doomed. There's no hope at all. So what do you do? What's religion done? Well, it says there's God, and then there's the great God above that. Brahma, Parabrahma, you know, in Hinduism, for instance. So what we do in spiritual reorientation is gently, kindly, lovingly, gradually see the whole situation as it is without trying to attack or get rid of anything in the situation. We don't want to say, you know, this God, you know, get rid of it. And I say, no. For the time being, you can believe that the instructions of how to get out are coming from this God that you're imagining. That's fine. But it's even more helpful to believe it's coming from this Holy Spirit. Okay. Because in the back of our minds we say, maybe this Holy Spirit is related to something else other than this imaginary God I've been appeasing, but trying to appease through killing, annihilating all these clay figures, you know. Maybe there's something else going on, you know, maybe. So it's helpful to have this God, the Holy Spiritism, okay, to introduce this. Very helpful. And certainly those who have this God, the Holy Spiritism, historically have been shown to make a great deal of progress in spiritual reorientation, seem to be more successful at it. The upshot of this is the realization that we're already not in this deep incarceration at all. That we're merely standing on this perfectly level plane where there's no darkness, no hiding places at all. In fact, we're not even in any danger at all from our friend trying to annihilate us. We were only engaging in whimsical pretense. The entire situation was only pretense. This is the goal that we're headed towards. But you can see how it's not an easy, comfortable goal to reach because we've invested so much in belief in protective deities, so to speak, a protective deity of our situation, of our hiding place, that it's not easy to realize that if there is no protective hiding place at all, then there's also no protective deity, is there? That too was our imagination. And this is a difficult gap to get over, isn't it? So this is why at some point on a spiritual reorientation, we have this leap of faith, which is to say that none of this ever happened, actually. I was never in any pit. I was never incarcerated in that pit. I was never a body. There's never been any God protecting my incarceration in this deep pit as a body. None of that ever happened. It's 100% just pretense, imagination, hallucination, pretense. I've been pretending because on this level plane, there was no place to hide at all. So I said, wow, what can I do? Well, I just can freeze up and pretend that all this happened. This is all happening as if that would bring me safety. But the real truth is my friend is not trying to annihilate me. And in fact, I cannot be annihilated because I'm complete sovereign over all my experiencing. So this was all just an extremely whimsical impulse that I had, just for the fun of it, as a game that I wanted to play. That's it. That's all that there is to it. So this is the ultimate realization that we're going towards here on this path. But we can certainly appreciate the difficulty of it and the fear that we have, because as we start to wake up, we start realizing, wow, maybe that God that I was imagining isn't so powerful after all. Can't really protect me like I thought it could, you know. You get nervous. It's nervous. And plus, there's the issue of tremendous relief in realizing that you're not even incarcerated at all. Just imagine that you've spent eons believing that you're incarcerated in this 100-mile deep tomb, completely incarcerated by all a trillion tons of stone everywhere, pitch darkness, completely isolated, completely alone. Imagine that we've been believing in this for so long, that this is true, that this is what we're experiencing is completely true. And imagine then that you catch a glimpse that none of this is true. It never happened. You're not incarcerated in the slightest bit. Imagine the wow of this feeling. It's like too good to be true, isn't it? It's like this news is such great news, you don't even know what to say. You don't even know how to react to it. You can't believe it. You can hardly believe it. It's such great news. So this is what I say is the wowness of the spiritual path, of the spiritual reorientation, is a better way to put it than a path, because a path assumes that somehow we're climbing our way out of this pit, which we're not actually. We're realizing we've never been in the pit. This is why what's called the path of gradualism is only a temporary expedient, and at some point you have to shift, which is called a leap of faith, which I call fourth phase. You shift and take this leap of faith, and you get into this all-readiness. Your practicing then changes into all-readiness, where you realize, I'm already not in any pit. And it goes, I already know that I've never been in any pit. And you start practicing that way. And this is called the direct approach, which is ultimately the final step, so to speak, is to realize there are no steps. The final step is to realize there's never been any steps at all. But only when you think you've gotten far, almost getting out of that pit, you know, you've really made a lot of progress, only then can you really make this shift in practicing, where you start practicing the realization that there's never been any pit at all. Right? This is this big shift in practicing, which is I call the fourth phase. I see like three different phases in spiritual reorientation that precede this, where you gradually wean yourself away from your fears and concerns and all this. But that path of gradualism can never actually succeed to get out of the pit, because you're still believing that there is a pit. Okay. Which isn't true. There is no pit. There is no pit at all. So you're still not realizing that you made it all up. That you've just completely made this up and been imagining it the whole time. And so you're not truly accepting that you're sovereign over your own experiencing. You're perfectly free, and that no one can, you cannot be annihilated. You're not realizing this was all a whim. You're still taking it seriously, like it all happened. But you're just fortunate enough to finally get out of the pit. You know, but you still got this problem. You're thinking, but still, I've got to find a better hiding place. So you still have this feeling like, okay, I'm getting out of the pit, which is great. But then where is this better hiding place, you know? Like, that's still there. In this leap of faith, it is then you suddenly realize, oh, wait a minute, I made the whole thing up. including that I was being pursued by this terrible force that wanted to destroy me. That too was completely made up, doesn't exist either. Therefore, I don't have to find any hiding place. the dream can be finished. Dream's finished then at that point. So this is why the fourth phase is quite different than the first three phases, which is why it's not for everybody. Not everybody's there yet. But certainly we look with great love and kindness upon all those in the first three stages, and even those who are not even started yet, who are still, you know, believing in that they're so fortunate to be saved in this way, you know, saved in your bodies in a world and time, space, process, and form in this pit, this imaginary pit of time, space, process, and form, and bodies and worlds that they're not even interested in any reorientation. They still even look kindly upon them, because sooner or later, and probably sooner in most cases, they're going to say, "Wow, I still don't feel right. I still feel this is feeble. I got to find a better hiding place and help, help, help." And then the Holy Spirit will say, "Okay, I'll get you out of this hiding place. Don't worry, don't worry, don't worry." Now the Holy Spirit doesn't say right out, "Hey, there is no hiding place," because you'll freak out. It says, "I'll get you out of this hiding place. I'll get you out of this situation. Don't worry." Okay. And it attracts you to the idea of getting out of this place, like attracting the children of the burning house to these nice toys outside of the house. "Look at these toys outside of the house. Oh yeah," they say, "these are better toys than what we have. We're going to go to those toys." And so they leave the burning house. And ultimately, when they reach the toys, they realize, "Oh, you know, I don't even need these toys. They're not really interested in these toys after all." And they look and say, "Oh, thank God I got out of the burning house." And then, oof, there was no burning house. In fact, all this was a dream. So it goes like that. So the Holy Spirit teaching the reorientation doesn't press certain things right away. Doesn't try to force the issue on that, because that's counterproductive. That drives us back into more fear. So this is why there's a definite bifurcation in terms of the stages, especially from when you go into the fourth stage, as I call this fourth stage. Then really, you know, the way you look at it is totally different than the first three stages. You really see it quite differently. And those in those first three stages kind of look at you as like, you know, "You're kind of scary, you know, you're kind of scary to them." It's like, "I can't really handle too much of this, really." They can handle a little bit of it, maybe, a little bit of it, but not much. And you have to accept that fact. Let the Holy Spirit do His work. Let the Holy Spirit, you know, work on this gradual reorientation. It really takes quite a bit of doing, because our fears are so intense. Yeah, and we just have been trying to defend against these fears in the most, you know, bizarre way, including believing that God is this deity that is, you know, protecting and making sure that we stay in this deep pit, and making sure that we, you know, continue to sacrifice these bodies to appease the wrath of this God. And, you know, this you know, incredibly silly misconception of God, so to speak. So all of that is part of it, but it doesn't bother the Holy Spirit at all. The Holy Spirit is not fooled by any of this. It knows its business. So let the Holy Spirit help everyone out. And let us pay attention to this fourth phase, which is what we're in here now, which is characterized by those who realize that God does not have any of these characteristics that we've been imagining, you know, for so long, of that God didn't make bodies, God did not make death, God did not make space, time, process, or form. God doesn't have this design of nature. God did not make nature. None of that is true. God does not demand sacrifice, or God cannot become flesh. You know, all this stuff that we've been believing in the past, we believe that protects us, you know, that we feel that God, this protector God of our incarceration, loves us so much that God became flesh so that he could identify with how important it is to be incarcerated like this, so that God would never, ever, ever stop protecting us from this incarceration, knowing how terrible we feel, you know, how frightened we feel. God said, oh yeah, I get it now, because now I became flesh and I truly can understand, you know, how important it is for you to be incarcerated forever. And you know, that, of course, is part of the silliness that we, in the fourth phase, we recognize that that was silliness, of course, but we understand and forgive ourselves for the silliness, and we don't judge those who still have the silliness, because at one point we were there too. At one point we were there too, for sure. It may have been several lives ago, right? Yeah, or maybe just the past life we had some of that, you know, and maybe even this life we had some residual of that too, right? Which is fine. But this was all an attempt to protect ourselves. We wanted to feel like, what can we do to get God on our side to protect us here and make sure that that this terrible monster that's trying to destroy us can't dig down here, you know? And we wanted God to empathize with us and see, God, you just, if you understood just how frightened we feel, you would for sure protect us forever, right? And you'd never be angry with us again. Never. So if you can just come into this world, God, and be flesh and prove that you're flesh by dying, suffering death, then we'll feel safe down here, and we'll know that you'll always protect us and never forsake this protective function you have, and make sure that we always stay incarcerated in this deep dark tomb. Okay, you can understand where this comes from. And you can forgive yourself, forgive everyone for believing all this. It's perfectly understandable given the whimsical nature of our game, right? Given the utterly whimsical nature of our game, that suddenly imagining that somehow we're vulnerable to being annihilated, that our friend has some power to annihilate us, you know? This it's all totally understandable as logical progressions of this insane whimsicality, this idea that we had. So we certainly do forgive ourselves. We certainly do forgive ourselves. We absolutely do. And we forgive the others who are still engaged in this silly game, including those who are, as of yet, have not even invoked God yet to protect them. They think, you know what? We can figure out some clever defenses down here. We're gonna let's work with electromagnetism and shock anybody. Anyone tries to come here, we're gonna shock them so badly that they'll be killed or something. And yeah. That too, you know, that all too is silly. But we forgive them for their they have a different style of defense. They may say, well, we don't need to imagine a God that protects us. We'll just imagine that there's ways to protect ourselves here. But ultimately, they too, at some point, will likely invoke God to protect them, because these other ways that they're, you know, electromagnetic technologies and various things, that still feels feeble too, you know. So we forgive the whole situation, and seeing it as it is, oh, okay, wow, what a joke, what a idiotic, whimsical notion I had, huh? That's, I don't think I'm going to play that game again. That's sort of like a parody of freedom, you know. It's sort of like, let me parody. Ultimately, though, we realize it actually was an attempt on our part to deceive God, to trick God into thinking that all this was possible. And therefore, God is a God of these possibilities. And therefore, this God is not really, truly what we believe, what we know God to be. That God is now this God of these possibilities. So God is lesser than before, which means that somehow we believe, oh, then that means we're spirit, we're greater than God. We're greater than God. What's the difference between God and Father, God the Son, or God the Spirit? God prime creator, God the Spirit. Well, it's like this. Think of God the prime creator as pure potentiality. Absolute pure potentiality. Eternally pure potentiality that is never lessened by any expression of that potentiality, and think of God the Son as the expression of that potentiality, choosing this experience, that experience, out of this pure potentiality that always remains all potential, pure potentiality of any and all experiencing, which is never diminished by whatever is expressed as experiencing. This is a good way to look at the difference between God the Father and God the Son, God the Prime Creator, God Spirit. The Spirit is God the Prime Creator, pure potentiality, God the Spirit, as the expressions, the choices of experiencing from that pure potentiality. I want to experience this out of that pure potentiality. Now I want to experience this. And so that completes the Godhood, so to speak. Pure potentiality without choosing experiencing of it seems to be somehow, you know, unfinished, as it were. And then God the Holy Spirit is the blessing upon God the Prime Creator, God the Spirit, which shows us the way to forgive ourselves for this whimsical idea, basically. And basically, the reminder that yes, indeed, this is the one and only reality. And it stays as a blessing once it's done its work, awakening us from our terrible pretense dream of this incarceration. It remains as a blessing of reality. So we're in the fourth phase here. We're in the fourth phase here, and in this fourth phase, we become more and more and more aware of the overall situation. Become less and less afraid to recognize this. And we have experiences and clarifications which bring up this wow, like, wow, it was all a dream. Wow, I really am getting free of this. We get reinforced more and more strongly that we really are waking up from this terrible dream, that A, it is a dream, B, we are truly waking up from it. We're succeeding. And so this brings a tremendous wow factor into us, because we start to realize, you know, I'm going to be, you know, overflowing with delight pretty soon. You know, it's like, wow. I haven't been feeling that for quite, you know, that's been, I've been estranged from that, really. I just can't hardly remember that at all. And so we have this stress in the wow, like, wow, this is great, but it's, you know, it's like coming out of frostbite. You don't want to go too fast. And so we need to discipline ourselves, very disciplined here, to make sure that we account for this wow factor, because it really does get more stronger and stronger and stronger. That's why Jesus said it's better for you if I leave, because for several reasons, actually there are a number of reasons. The principle we're speaking of here is that you can overdo the wow factor if you're not careful. You can overdo it. And hanging out with one who has awakened from this dream entirely, you know, this is really a tremendous wow factor involved in this. And you can overdo that. And then you start getting frightened, and you start saying, whoa, 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 I want to go back hide. I need a hiding place. Where's the hiding place? And then you can misinterpret the one who's woken up as a protector of this new hiding place, someone who's showing you a new hiding place and how to be protected in that new hiding place. And then you make an idol of them, you know, it's an idol of your imagination, of your friend, actually. And so Jesus said, you know, it's better for you that I go and I leave the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit will, you know, bring you through these various phases, clarify it for you until you really are able to very directly, right? He said, I'm speaking very indirectly to you through parables and metaphors and syllogisms and various methods, because you're not able to get it directly yet. He says, but once the Holy Spirit has really clarified it, for the truth for you, eventually I'll be able to speak to you very directly. And this very direct way of showing us the truth, this approach, very direct approach, is this fourth phase, which is this all-readiness. I know I'm already saved. I know I'm already enlightened. I know I'm already free. I already know. Yes, I already know that I've never been born. See, never been born as some clay figure down in this terrible pit, right? I already know that I've never been born. I already know that nothing has ever been born. I already know that there is no pit. You see, I already know that nothing has ever happened. See, all these happenings in the pit, none of that ever took place, actually, except in our imagination, except in our pretense, pretending that it was taking place. So we practice it. I already know this. This is very direct. It's very direct because it takes time out of the equation, doesn't it? I already know it. Yes, I already know. Or because I already see it, but I use this term, since we're practicing, I use the term here, know. We're using the term know. I already know it. Yes, I already know. And there's another form of practice where we use the seeing, like I'm overflowing with the light to see that I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Meaning, I'm not in any pit. I'm not a body at all. I'm not in any pit, I'm free. I'm still spirit, meaning I'm not anything that could ever be incarcerated. I'm spirit, formless spirit. I can't be incarcerated in some pit with a bunch of, you know, it's impossible. I'm still exactly as God created me, meaning I have this dream experience I've had hasn't changed me in any way whatsoever. I'm still exactly as God created me. So I'm overflowing with the light to see that I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And to combine the two, yes, I already know that I'm overflowing with delight to see that I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Or we could say, I'm already overflowing with delight. That's another way we can do it. Yes, I already know that I'm already overflowing with delight. There's another way. Yes, I already know that I'm already overflowing with delight to see that I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. So this is the phase four style of practice. Very different practice than before. Once you get into this, you're not going to go back to the old style of practice at all. No way. Praying to a protective God, please God, you know, I'm so, you know, please protect me here. I'm such a frail body in this deep, dark pit. Please, there's some people trying to get into this pit and devour me. Please, you know. Please help me. I'm such, you know, terrible sinner, you know, and I'm sorry I've angered you and all. Now, you know, that there was a time for that. Okay, there was a time for that. And now you've lightened up enough to realize, hey, you know, I've been imagining all this. So we now practice in a different way. When we're a child, we crawl, and infant we crawl, and then we become a child. We get in our toddling stage, and then we get into our smoother walking stage and running, and it's like that. So the different phases. So now we're in this direct phase. As I use the story of Buddha and his party, his sangha traveling with Buddha, and came across the Ganges River, was swollen very high and very rapid and turbulent, and nobody could cross it, and people were frantically trying to devise some way to get across it, and then Buddha just, you know, and they were all on the other side just like that, and Buddha said that, you know, the people, they try to devise ways and means to cross the river, but the wise are already on the other side. They're already on the other side. See, we're already free. We're already standing in this beautiful plane of reality, actually, that all is plain. We're already not threatened. we're already not in any pit. We're already, see, we're already that. So this is the way we have to practice. The wise practice this way. This is what Buddha was getting at. The wise practice this way. Already-ness. So, now, we're not infallible in this fourth phase. We're still beginners here, and we're prone to make mistakes and misinterpretations, and we're still struggling, of course. And we're not afraid to re-examine our interpretations, previous interpretations, and clean them up a little bit if we need to. And for example, I had a dream that I've talked about where I said I met Jesus and spoke with Jesus and was invited to his place, and I felt that it was likely Jesus because I didn't know who else it could possibly be. Because the way the dream was presented was, it was presented to me that this one has been responsible for more of us coming home to reality than anyone else. And so I said, well, it must be Jesus. You know, who else could it possibly be? And then recently I was going through various things, studying, and I came across this idea that Jesus is not this white person, white Caucasian person with long hair, you know, the way we look at Jesus usually. And they said, you know, back in those days, nobody had long hair. I mean, Paul said, you know, that long hair was an abomination. Nobody, you know, that's nobody has long hair. And it's quite likely Jesus did not have that long flowing hair that we're seeing. And in that area at that time, the people of that time in Eric's, et cetera, they were likely fairly dark-skinned, actually, pretty swarthy and dark-skinned. And the upshot of all this is that the pictures, the paintings that we, the way that Jesus is depicted throughout most of history, very likely doesn't have anything to do with how the actual body of what Jesus looked like. Not way off. And so I said, yeah. I said, well, maybe that's why the person I saw in the dream didn't actually look like the Jesus that we're used to. It was actually a fairly dark-skinned person with very short, curly hair. And the Jewish people at that time, I don't think they had hair quite like that, not quite that dark, quite that. I said, so as long as I was thinking about that, I said, if it wasn't Jesus, who could it possibly have been? Who could have possibly have led more to salvation than Jesus? I think that is. Well, anyway, so I was in my studies, I was going through some Buddhist, familiarizing myself with some of the Buddhist history, because it's quite extensive. And I came across some iconography of Buddha, and something that I've always wondered is why is Buddha often depicted as having these little swirl in his head, is all these like little swirls of look like hair, like not, you know. I said, what is the meaning of that? Now, I'm sure there's some esoteric meaning of that, but I still said, you know, that's kind of odd. Whereas in other depictions of Buddha, it has long flowing hair that's pulled up to a top knot, you know. There's a difference in iconography of Buddha. One that seems to have really tight, kinky hair throughout, you know, super short. And then it flashed in my mind, I said, that type of hair reminds me of the hair of the person in the dream that I was visiting with. And I said, yeah, but the skin was dark, you know. And Buddha's usually depicted as pale with or golden in color. But I also came across a lot of there are depictions of Buddha as actually being dark-skinned. And there's actually, we don't know exactly, but it is the, what the Shakyamuni, the Shakya clan, of that era, could very well have been actually dark-skinned, quite dark-skinned. Now, I'm not to the extent of like in the those from Africa, that type of skin tone, but nevertheless dark skinned. Okay, certainly not light skinned. And they could have very well had, you know, this more curly, real short, kinky sort of hair, like that. And then I thought, well, if that is so, that would match the person in the dream that I was visiting with. And then in going through the history of Buddhism, you know, I'm very impressed with the sheer numbers of those who have actually been liberated in following, you know, Buddhist practicing, which actually there's many schools and sects that it's divided into a massive swamp of different, slightly different nuances. There's just, you know, incredible different number of nuances throughout the long history of that. But the truth is that there have been a great many who have been liberated from this dream, this pretense, through the various practice of the Dharma, the various practices that have arisen, which are many, 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 many different practices. And I said, whoa, wait a minute, let me revisit that dream. Was that Buddha that I was actually visiting with at that time? You know, I said, well, it's quite possible, actually, because the parameters I had was I was aware this one is responsible for liberating more from this dream than anyone else. You know, plus the dark skin, the super short hair, the tight kinky hair. You know, and I said maybe it was Buddha actually. I don't know for sure. I don't know for sure. I said, I'm not for sure, you know, but I don't know. Maybe Jesus, the path has liberated more. I don't know. But just from the historical record, I would say probably Buddhism has been responsible for the liberation of more than any. It's you know, older, it's been around longer, and it's been, it's very impressive. All the different teachers that no doubt have taught are many. There are many, many different lineages and many teachers in those lineages, and many have been liberated. There's no question about it. Well, that would be kind of cool. That's kind of a wow, that you know, visiting with Buddha. But the same applies, you know, the same what I said about it was just the complete unpretentiousness of this being. The calmness, the serenity, the unpretentiousness, no spiritual ego, and just this beautiful spirit, you know, is just completely relaxed and calm, smiling, you know, friendly, like your best friend and all of that. And so this is common with the experiences I've had with Jesus. And the thing about Jesus is I've never been able to really get what he looks like, you know, when I've been visiting with him. I've never gotten an image of what he looks like exactly. So, which is, I guess, fine. Ananda Maima, Ramana Maharshi, Longchenpa, Krishnamurti, those are the ones that I've visited with, that I'm aware of. And they're all just beautiful, beautiful friendship is what you feel. Like they're your best friend, and you just, you know, you're just walking with them or sitting with them. Just like in the analogy, that narrative I used, where you're walking along with your best friend and then suddenly had this whim that you're going to play this game that your best friend is now trying to pursue you and annihilate you. And we begin to wake up. What do we become aware of? Well, we become aware of this friend. It's like, wow, I have this really, really wonderful friend, and they're like really totally wonderful. They're not trying to annihilate me at all. And so coming across these quote-unquote spiritual teachers, saviors, gurus, avatars, etc. Ananda Maima was an avatar of what they call Vishnu, or the Parabrahman, the supreme god, so to speak, an appearance. Of course, she knew she wasn't a body. In fact, she knew that bodies don't even exist. And they asked her, how do we appear to you? And she says, I don't see any body at all. I see this glowing golden orb of scintillating beautiful light. That's how I actually see you. So when we say, well, how could God come into this world? Some people say Jesus was incarnation of God. Well, how could that happen? They don't really come into the world, is the answer. Well, how could they have a body? They don't have a body. See, they see it truly. They're not in any world, and they don't have a body. From our perspective, we see them in a world and not in a body. That's a misperception. It's a misperception. It's our misperception. So that's the answer of how, quote-unquote, God can appear to us as avatars of saviors, is that we think it's a body, but from the standpoint of God, nothing can ever be born. There's no body at all. It's just a hologram of light, okay, that we're interpreting in a certain way. So this is why we can have these avatars. And Anamayama was an avatar, actually. Which made her very difficult to relate to in some ways, actually. Yeah. And then we have others that are just, you know, examples of our friend who've woken up from this dream, and so now they appear to us as our dear friend. Like, I'm just hanging out, like, wow, what this, who is this? You know, like, Ramana Maharshi, when I visited with him, it was like, it was just this most wonderful friend, you know, this person who's so friendly. I couldn't help but feel like, wow, this is my friend. I just felt, right away, I decided, this is a friend of mine, a really great friend of mine. You know, it gives you that feeling that they're a really dear friend of yours. Well, yeah, they most certainly are. Because they represent that, so you know, that friend that we imagined this game with, right? That is still our friend, perfect friend. But we imagine this game that they're out to try and annihilate us, but actually they weren't. So we have these experiences where we meet up with these great, we call them, you know, great teachers or something, but really great friends. And it just, we feel like, wow, what a wonderful friend this is. You know, I'd like to see them more often, and this is part of our awakening. This is part of the wow situation. So if I thought this was Buddha that I was actually visiting with, I might have freaked out, actually. And truth be told, I've never even considered, you know, hanging out with Buddha or meeting Buddha or anything like that. It's never been part of my, you know, consideration, really. Never thought it possible, or, you know, just no. I'm never crossed my mind, really, in any strong way. I would say never crossed my mind in some sort of strong way, never crystallized into some kind of goal or anything like that. So it never crossed my mind that this could be Buddha that I was visiting with. Never crossed my mind. But if it had crossed my mind, I most likely would have freaked out. Because I just, you know, it would just been like, I just don't know what to say. You know, I'm not aware enough, you know, what do I deserve? How do I deserve this? You know, how could I possibly deserve this? Are you kidding me? Now, I've been working with Jesus for so long, so of course I feel like I deserve to spend time with Jesus. I'm paying attention to what he says. He's helping me reorient, you know, reorient and wake up from the dream. So, but to visit with Buddha and Buddha be there is like, wow, why am I so honored like this? This is, what did I do to deserve this? You know, that would be my question. And I might feel like I don't deserve this. Because Buddha is certainly known as you know, the great practitioner, bringing all these great practices. He was super, super, super knowledgeable about ways and means, the Dharma, the ways and the means of skillful practice. And Buddhists are so skillful in all this. Some might say that they've maybe overdone it, over-attenuated it to certain degrees, right? And split too many hairs. But there's no question that the Buddha is a master of all these practices. And so I would say, wow, what do I deserve? Does deserve this? I'm me. I'm just barely beginning, or actually when I had this dream, I wasn't even beginning this type of already practice at all. But I was certainly ain't going in that direction, you know. And so I had been practicing for a year and a half or so, pretty intensely. So maybe at that point I had earned enough to deserve actually visiting with Buddha, because it was saying, yeah, you're becoming a practitioner. you're getting it, and that's great. So the benefit of spiritual reorientation is you do actually come across these great teachers. You do. These great friends. So we can realize, hey, my friend isn't out to try and destroy me. Now, these teachers are not superior to us at all, just as when you're walking together in reality with your friend, you're not superior to them and they're not superior to you. You're both absolutely free, and you both know this. It's only that when we had this whimsical idea of being chased, you want to be chased, and you have the whimsical idea that, oh, my friend is trying to destroy me, kill me, you know, that your feelings changed. And then you ultimately got into this whole idea of wanting to be protected and thinking that there's something greater than you and less, and that you're less and greater. So we tend to look at these great teachers, these great practitioners, these great experts, experts in spiritual reorientation, that they're somehow someone greater than us. You know, they're so much greater, we're just nothing compared. This is not true. We're equal, actually. They're just our friends. When we truly wake up, we'll realize, oh, we're both complete sovereigns over our experiencing, and we're all one, and we're all completely both totally free, and so there isn't any of this hierarchy like that, actually. The hierarchy only comes into play in a relativistic sense of this program of spiritual reorientation, where there are experts, okay, in this, and there is a gradation of expertise in assisting in this reorientation. But once you awaken from this ridiculous dream that we've been engaged in, then you realize there is no actual stratification in spirit whatsoever. All is equal, all is one. So that's the ultimate realization. And then if in terms of pragmatism, there seems to be, like the Buddha, of course, is much more expert than me in practices, you know. But in terms of spirit, we're completely equal, just as you're completely equal also to everyone. There's no difference. How could there be any inequality in perfect freedom? It's not possible. How can there be any inequality in God, which is just simply pure potential? And we're simply spirit, that which chooses to play with pure potential. And all is equal to God. You can choose to play with any idea you want to choose. It's all the same to God, actually. It's just that God wants you to play with some idea. You got to play with some idea, right? But as far as what, you're free to play with any idea you want. God is not judging greater or lesser at all with this. So all spirit is one and the same in terms of this oneness, and nothing higher or lower, okay? Not at all. But had I known, if it was the Buddha indeed, had I known it was, I would have, you know, maybe snapped into this relativistic mindset, which, of course, Buddha would not want me to do that, being a face for a practitioner, but not want that at all. So, you know, maybe in that case, ignorance was bliss for a little while. And I just got a feel for the vibe of this being, you know, and just said, wow, this is a very serene, relaxed, unconcerned being, to say the least. I was talking about the world and the troubles, and they just smiled and said, yeah, I've had a lot of experience with all of this, and been working at it for a long time, and no worries, don't worry. You know, I said, yeah, it's really difficult and tough, and they said, don't worry, everything's fine, everything's under control. And so it was this reassurance of someone who had a tremendous amount of experience in everything that's happened in this world and this whole spiritual reorientation, and yet was completely unfazed by it, completely unworried by it, and didn't have any agitation over it or concern whatsoever. And I was so surprised. I said, wow, look at the world this time. We're being, you know, we're being incorporated by cosmic corporate culture and taken over by these, you know, barbarians. And this, you know, and I don't know what to do here. This is like terrible. And yet they were completely unconcerned and unbothered by this. They acknowledged it. They said, yeah, this is, but you know, business as usual, right? I mean, they have this tremendous perspective of the situation. And so what happens is you visit with them and it begins to get into you like, hey, there is a perspective that I can have where I too can be unconcerned ultimately by this, right? And so this narrative that I've given tonight, thanks to the Holy Spirit, I had no plans on giving this narrative about, you know, that you've heard from the beginning of this video. This helps us, certainly has helped me become less concerned about the situation. Yes, it is very virulent in terms, in a relativistic way, okay? But in the picture, ultimate picture of spiritual reorientation, the plan of spiritual reorientation is still totally viable and will always be so. And it's just a matter of those of us going in that direction at some point. And when we do, we will certainly go through those phases rather quickly and ultimately realize we don't need this dream anymore. So this Buddha, if it was indeed the Buddha, was not troubled about this at all in that way. At the same hand, they were aware that it was a quite unruly time. You see, there's both were there, but they weren't concerned or upset about it. They weren't freaking out about it at all. And then the end was, hey, would you like to come visit my dwelling place? And I said, yeah, sure, that'd be great. I don't know where that is exactly. And he said, it's very close by, actually. And then there was some indication to me that it was something about middle, in the middle. So I don't know exactly, you know, what this meant. Was it meant visited the mind stream of the middle way, of the middle way or something? Or was it an actual quote-unquote spiritual location, or exactly what it was? But there was this invitation given, which I felt was a tremendous opportunity. So I said, sure, yeah. I don't consider myself a Buddhist. I consider myself more a Christian. But at the same hand, the Christianity that the world is engaged in I don't really fit in that, because I'm in, you know, fourth phase. You realize that all of those accommodations that happen in the first phases, you know, the artifacts of fear, you know, I don't need those anymore. So, you know, I don't really fit into the idea, their idea of what a Christian is, Christianity, what a Christian is. But certainly in terms of working with Jesus, I consider myself a Christian in that way, because of working with A Course in Miracles and working with A Journey Beyond Words. Those are the teachings of Jesus. So I certainly, you know, consider myself, you know, in that way. But then also I certainly greatly respect and understand the wisdom of what Buddha also brought, the practicing, and certainly there is high practicing in Buddhism with the already practiced. There, many have succeeded. So I don't know. We just say that we're this walking together in the wowness is what we are. We don't really need to say we're this or that. You know, don't really need to identify with a particular religion at all, actually, at this point in phase four. You're more identified with a practice than a religion in phase four, actually. And actually, Longchenpa, a lot of his teachings, he basically says he's kind of here to liberate you from Buddhism, which means the gradualism of the first three phases, the fourth phase, the Dzogchen phase, is to liberate us from the other first three phases, you know, which is the, you know, is the gradualism of much of all religion, right? Whether Buddhism, Christianity, Islam, Hinduism, all the various great religions. there, of course, since it's spiritual reorientation, there's this gradualism in it, which a lot of mistakes are made in that gradualism. Artifacts of fear are there as we gradually wean ourselves away from this defensive system that we thought we needed. And so at some point, you take the leap of faith, fourth phase, and at that point, you're not really, from the standpoint of the world, you don't really fit into any of these religious traditions so much anymore. And so Longchenpa really came to free the Buddhists from Buddhism. Okay? And he may have come to help me out, or help us out, actually, in response to my prayer for help, to make sure that we don't fall back into the first three phases of Buddhism, to protect us from that, actually, because there's certainly that sidetrack possibility where we start to become masters of the first three phases instead of going and shifting into the fourth phase. And what Longchenpa is certainly very adamant and expert about is to help us not do that, okay? Because this is a pitfall that certainly grabs some of us, maybe many of us at some point, where as we go along, we still have this idea, well, I got to find some hiding place, you know, and we think that we can find it in becoming experts about the various religions and the first three phases, becoming experts of that, and in doing so, we stall out and we refuse to take the leap of faith into the fourth phase practice, which is this already practice. The wise are already on the other bank. There's already practice, and so we don't do it. This is a problem. And so it may be that Longchenpa came here and said, "Hey, look, listen to this Dzogchen here," and realize that this transcends the gradualism of the whole corpus of Buddhism. It also, and he says, get into this all-readiness practice. And so it helped me make this leap of faith and say, okay. And Jesus saying the same thing. He says, you need to get into, ultimately, you need to get into this as-if practice and imagine as if this were already true. So Longchenpa saying, hey, no, don't try to become some expert in Buddhism. No, stay away from that. The first three phases, that's a side trip. It's a delaying trip. Make the leap. And being the great Buddhist that he is, many say that he's one of, you know, puts him on an equal, almost, you know, very basically equal standing of Gautama Buddha, etc. He's one of the Buddhas. This has a lot of impact when he's saying this and coming to help us like this. If Buddha says, hey, don't get into Buddhism, so to speak, that carries a lot of weight. It says, transcend it. Tell him to transcend it, and I'm already free. I'm already awakened. I already know. I'm already the Buddha, you know. I'm already the Buddha. Yes, I already know. I'm already the Buddha. I'm already Buddha mind, or I'm already free. So don't try to get... So this is how I see it. This is how I see it. The likely what happened is I was going towards practicing, and there's some of us in this world who are going towards this fourth phase, and yet the temptation is to use our clarity to become experts in the first three phases and then set ourselves up as some sort of intellectual experts on religion. You see, that's a very much a temptation. And Longchenpa came along and said, no, I'm going to make sure that you don't do that. And of course, Jesus all along is telling us we need to not do that. But sometimes we need a kick in the seat of the pants from outside of our tradition. And also because becoming experts in religion would mean you're going to become an overall expert in the other various religions. Someone coming from the Buddhist tradition saying you don't need to become an expert in that. Okay. One of the ultimate experts in Buddhism would be Longchenpa coming to you and saying, don't worry, you don't need to be an expert in any of that. Take this leap of faith and do the four-stage practice. That's very helpful. That is very helpful. Same thing with Ramana Maharshi coming to me and saying, don't worry about what I taught, which is really, master of Advaita Vedanta. He said, do it your way. The way you're doing is great. You know, so in other words, you don't have to be an expert in Advaita, you know. Path that Shankara laid out so beautifully, and he had several teachers. There's a couple of lineage, a couple of teachers that he came from that were essential, you know, teachers of interpreting the Vedas. And Ramana said, "What you're doing, you know, two thumbs up. It's great. Keep doing it. Keep doing it. You're going to succeed that way." So I never felt like I had to be an expert in you know, Vedantin non-dualism, all that, you know, the whole Hindu teachings and all that. I didn't need to be an expert in that. Same thing with Ananda Maima, is helping out with that. So, which helped with a lot of the bhakti, you know, stuff, a lot of the various aspects of Hinduism, which is, there's a lot to it. And I said, I don't need to be an expert in any of that. So I don't need to really be an expert, you know, in these various areas at all. And then that protects you from falling into this trap of setting yourself up as some sort of pundit, you know, which this world really is craving for, this whole incorporation of this planet into secular, humanistic secular materialism. They want to see the pinnacle of spirituality as these pundits. Okay, that's what they want. And so they'll set you up as a bigwig. If you're willing to be a pundit, they will really, you know, say, you're it. You can write all these books, become very famous and rich and powerful and everybody. You know, and if you're willing to be a pundit, which is an expert on religious traditions, what do they call it? Study of, there's all sorts of fancy academic words for all this stuff. Doxology, soterology, and various things about studying the path to salvation and, you know, comparative theology and religion, all this stuff. Yeah, you're gonna, so this world is seducing us into that, really, very severely, because they don't recognize true liberation at all. This secular humanistic despotism, which this world is has become, doesn't recognize that at all. But they will recognize a pundit, you see. So if you want to feel that you're in alignment with the direction this world is going in, then you will feel you need to be a pundit. So that is a very real danger for those who, for myself, who certainly has the capacity to be a pundit par excellence, actually. If I took that path, I could certainly be a very, very skillful pundit in all of this. And I could just play the song, and I could play all these songs if that was really what I decided to do. And so I have these teachers, Jesus, Ramana, Ananda Maima, Longchenpa, and now perhaps Buddha, saying, no, don't do that. You don't need to do that. And we're telling you, we're absolutely assuring you that that is not the way. And we're advising you to go into this four-stage practice of all readiness. Without their help, I'm sure I would have, you know, most likely fallen into that trap of punditism. You know, the sage that can drop, can talk, this just as, oh my gosh, you come across them. I've come across them. And, you know, they're just like, kaboom, kaboom, kaboom. They just lay it all on you. And you think, oh my gosh, what a pundit, you know. What a pundit. And there's some very skillful pundits around, for sure. But I also say, what a shame. What a waste, actually. So I have come to free the pundits from punditism. That's stalling out. It's stalling out. It's getting a little chilly out here, for sure. I didn't dress very warmly, except I'm still being seduced by California daytimes here. 80 degrees, crystal blue sky, like summer. And the day is like fantastic right now. The next 4 days are supposed to be just like summer here. But the nights are still cold. Yeah, the nights are still cold. Well, cold here, we say, is like 42 degrees. You know, that's like really cold. We're pathetic out here, aren't we? Pathetic weaklings. Totally spoiled. Rotten. People back east are just like... My sympathies, really. It's been a really horrid winter back east. Across much of the United States. I know all the listeners are not from the United States. Thank God. Thank God there are viewers from all over the world here. United States is the leading force in incorporating this world into humanistic secular materialism. One of the leading forces. China's another one. So, just keep in mind that you may very well be living in a place that isn't nearly as bad as living here, and you'd be blessed. Actually, you're blessed. This living here is very, very tough, especially living in the Bay Area of California. You get the feeling that, you know, your life is in danger if people find out here that you don't believe what they believe, actually, on various social issues, whatever is the soup du jour of their angst and agitation and righteousness, you know, whatever is the soup du jour of their righteousness. If you're a fly in that soup, you know, they're gonna feel likely they're gonna crush you. So yeah, it's like you feel like you live in some ghetto, a Jew in a ghetto, World War II, and you've Germanized your name or something, and you live in fear like somebody might recognize your name or say your name, like, oh, aren't you, you know, Epstein, or aren't you something, you know, like, what, you know, oh my God, they know my, you know, they know my heritage or something, they know my name, you know, you're afraid like someone will actually know that you're actually, you know, know that your perspective or something. And, you know, you're going to be annihilated here in this place. Really? This is the home of the wrathful deities here. Even though they pretend they're benign deities, they are very wrathful here. Lest you dare have the temerity to at least question the absolute righteousness of their position. At least to say, no, wait a minute, yeah, let's not be so quick here to be so righteous on this. Maybe there's something else we should be focusing on, right? Maybe we just need to let these issues kind of, you know, work themselves out more in common sense ways instead of trying to, you know, bring the sledgehammer of legality down on everything here. And maybe there's some reasons why we have a very, religion is very conservative and modest and protects that severe modesty. Maybe there's a reason for all that. Maybe the purpose of religion is not to oppress everybody, but to spiritually reorient everybody. You know, and then maybe we need that reorientation. Oh my gosh, this is like a fly in their soup. They're like these connoisseurs in a restaurant and a fly in the soup. This is, you know, how dare you? How dare you fly in my, get in my soup? the most self-righteous place in the world. So, you know, count yourself very fortunate if you happen to live somewhere else, in spite of the nice weather here. In spite of the nice weather, they're not such nice people here, actually. Not though I would call nice, actually. They think they're very nice, as long as you agree in lockstep with them. Jackbooted lockstep, as long as you're that, oh, then, oh, aren't we wonderful? Aren't we wonderful people out here? Yeah. Well, this is how it is, isn't it? Throughout history. But it certainly gives me a front row seat to, you know, future, how to help in the future, you know, and to see the overall picture of the whole thing. And try to get that equanimity that the Buddha has and the teachers have about, don't worry, you know, they too will be saved. It's, you know, they eventually will be saved. Eventually they'll get tired of being in, you know, being in this terrible tomb of incarceration, making little clay bodies and destroying them, little clay figurines. Eventually they'll say, you know, this still feels feeble to me. Now keep in mind that one who's engaged in this intense pretense and dream, their whole idea is to make it real. So they want to totally forget that they're just pretending all of this. And nobody's chasing them, trying to annihilate them, and they're not vulnerable, and there's no pit, and there's no incarceration, there's no clay figurines. We're not these clay figurines, these bodies. We're not in this pit called the world. But the whole purpose is to forget that we're pretending. We want to completely forget that we're pretending. So there's no possibility we could stop pretending, right? So we don't want the authorship of any of this to be us. We project it onto this imaginary God. We're imagining that, oh, God is the author of all this. So we want this pretense to be solid, to be strong. And we want our forgetfulness to be entire. Now, when we start remembering and start seeing through all this, what happens? This pretense becomes very flimsy. We say, wow, that's a flimsy pretense. And we begin to see how flimsy all this righteousness, self-righteousness is. It becomes absurdly flimsy to us. So when we look at these righteous folks who are pretending that their pretenses are so absolutely rock solid, you know, and you look at it and say, this is absurd what you're saying. You know, you don't have any common sense, you don't have any wisdom, you know, it's ridiculous. We see it. It's flimsy, but from their standpoint, you know, you're the devil. You know, you're suggesting that their beliefs are flimsy. You know, their self-righteousness is flimsy. How dare you? You're an idiot. You know, you're worse than an idiot. You're dangerous. They really feel you're super dangerous to them. But you can understand why they feel that, because they feel that to recognize that this is a pretense then brings up the threat of annihilation to them. Not recognizing this was all a silly game that they're playing. They're not ready for that. So, you know, you got to be very careful what you say here in the Bay Area. In fact, you have to guard your every utterance and every response here. Really, literally. Don't dare let it be known that you're not in Jack Buddha lockstep with what they all believe. Because you will pay the price here. You most certainly will pay the price. They are, they can be vicious here. Wrathful deities. This is the home of wrathful deities here, you know. And I realize I cannot dispel all these wrathful deities because they're not ready for it to be dispelled. They're not ready yet. That this process of spiritual reorientation is a gradual process through the first three phases. So this old dilemma of sudden or gradual school, like for instance in Buddhism, is a red herring. It's a red herring. There's no disagreement there. There's no conflict there at all. It's both. This overall plan of spiritual reorientation, which we must all go through, is both. First, it's gradual, and then the leap of faith, and it turns into very direct. I'm already awake. I'm already awake. See? And we go towards this more quote-unquote sudden or total awakening. It's both. But there's these phases. So it's not both simultaneously. It's more like you go through the earlier phases and then you get ready for the fourth phase, which you're then acting as if you're already awake. You're believing and practicing this as if you're already awake. And then this becomes a very quick, direct kind of approach. But don't want to fall into punditism. But that doesn't mean you can't sprinkle a little bit of flavor, you know, a little salt and pepper. But certainly stay away from being a pundit. What do you do if you're already a pundit? Well, just say, hey, that was fun while it lasted. But, you know, I don't really need that anymore. Forgive yourself for it and say, but still say, you know, that was kind of fun, but, you know, I no longer see much value in it. I'm ready now to, you know, go into the fourth phase. That's all. Because we all kind of stall out in some ways. We all kind of stall out in some ways. So you basically just say, okay, you know, that's enough of that. I've been there, done that, and it's no longer that interesting to me. And now I realize that I really can. There's a fourth phase. I really can take the fourth phase, and some are doing it. And I might as well, you know, join the journey. Join the journey. Come on in. The water's fine. But don't expect people to, you know, be overly impressed with the punditism. And you got to drop that. You can't keep saying, "Hey, everybody, you know, look at what great pundit I am." You know, nobody's impressed by that. In this fourth stage, we're really not impressed by punditism, because we actually have a higher overview than the pundits do. And once you go into the fourth phase, you really understand. For instance, I had I was studying Buddhism in Wikipedia, and I came across this talk of Buddha talking about already on the other bank. And as I studied more Buddhism, suddenly I had this flash like lightning, and I saw that the whole thing is unnecessary. I saw the totality of Buddhism. I just said, yeah, I totally get it. It's now, for me, it's all completely unnecessary. Boom, just like that, like a flash, sudden. Because I said, it's all Buddhism is actually contained in this one word already. That's it. In fact, all practice is contained in that. All religion is contained in this one word. I saw it. It's all contained in that, which is already. I'm already free. I'm already perfect. I'm already what I am. I'm already awake. I'm already spirit. I'm already not a body. I'm already exactly as God created me. I already know that nothing has already not happened, you know. I already know that I already know. It's all contained. I saw everything contained in that one word. So this, you know, this perspective is higher than the perspective of a pundit. Because if the pundit really saw that, they would start practicing and say, hey, whoa, you know, I'm not going to waste my time anymore. I want to be liberated, truly liberated here. Because being a pundit is, you know, sure, you're a hero, and the secular humanists will idolize you, but being an idol is no fun at all, actually. You deserve better than that. Absolutely deserve better than that. So obviously, you know, someone who's seen the entirety of all religion is simply all contained in one word, you know, they're not going to be, you know, impressed or waste time on listening to pundits, blah, 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 blah. They say, hey, let's get to practice here, you know, come on. Yes, I already know that I'm already enlightened. Yes, I already know that I am already enlightened. And then this prepares us for that flash of insight, and then abiding in that, actually, and realizing that this perceiving this already-ness. I'm already not born. Everything is already not born. Everything is already unborn, actually. I'm already dwelling in unbornness. Yes, I already know I'm already dwelling in unbornness. Yes, I already know I'm already dwelling in unbornness, in the unborn oneness, in the all-inclusive unborn oneness. Yes, I already know I'm already dwelling in the all-inclusive unborn oneness. Yes, I already know that I'm already abiding in the already all-inclusive unborn oneness, the already all-inclusive unborn oneness, the already all-inclusive unborn oneness. I'm already abiding in that. Okay? So yes, I already know that I'm already abiding in the all-inclusive unborn oneness. Yes, I already know that I'm already abiding in the all-inclusive, unborn oneness. We can just practice this. And this gets our expectations oriented to this. So when our perception shifts and we see this, we say, yeah, oh yeah, I know I'm already here. Yeah, I know I'm already here. I just didn't have my eyes open yet, but I already knew that I was already here. It just, I hadn't opened my eyes. And so the last step is the shift of perception. We open our eyes and say, oh yeah, I see. I already have been dwelling in this all-inclusive unborn oneness. This all-inclusive unborn oneness. So, yes, I already know that I've already been dwelling. I'm already abiding in. Yes, I already know that I'm already abiding in this all-inclusive unborn oneness, this all-inclusive unborn oneness, this all-inclusive unborn oneness. Yes, I already know I'm already abiding in this all-inclusive unborn oneness. Yes, I already know I'm already abiding in this all-inclusive unborn oneness. So, what have we been doing in this video? We have been essentially flipping the script. What phase of practice we've been? We've been in flipping the script until we can get to this higher assertion, this more intense assertion, as it were. See, and then so now we got to this phase of assertion. Next phase is the wow. Once we build up a wow, then we full stop in the wow. So, yes, I already know that I'm already abiding in this all-inclusive unborn oneness. Yes, I already know that I am already abiding in this all-inclusive unborn oneness. Yes, I already know I'm already abiding in this all-inclusive unborn oneness. This is phase four practice, okay? The practice here in phase four, the practice is the guru. The practice is the guru. It's interesting that those I've met, these great teachers, they don't say, I'm here to be your guru. They say, what they've really done is they've pointed me to this practice, saying, this practice is the guru. Let this practice be your guru. This alreadyness. Yes, I already know. I'm already abiding in this all-inclusive, unborn oneness. And to have faith that this is so, because it actually is so. Have faith. Have our faith on this instead of faith that we're incarcerated in this incredibly deep, dark dungeon, right? Have faith that we're actually, yes, I already know that I'm already abiding in this all-inclusive, unborn oneness. Have faith in that as if I already am abiding there, that I'm already experiencing this. This is already true for me. It's already true for me. And eventually we'll open our eyes, so to speak, our perception will shift, and we'll see that, oh, this is so, oh yeah. And then we'll be very impressed by that, for sure. Very impressive. Okay, so I need to wind this video up because I'm starting to shiver here. Starting to shiver and get the shakes, and it takes a long time to get the cold out of, you know, the body once it gets this cold. So we have our next step in terms of assertion. This is a very, very great assertion. Yes, I already know that I'm already abiding in this all-inclusive unborn oneness. Yes, I already know I'm already abiding in this all-inclusive unborn oneness. So just try this out in your practicing and see if you can build up a wow around this. See if you can build up the spiritual buzz. And then once you build up this buzz to the maximum amount, then you just kind of let it settle down. Full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow. So hopefully we've done enough flipping the script here so we feel entitled to do this. That, yeah, we deserve this and we understand why we're doing this and it's the right thing to do, and so we do it. So yes, I already know that I am already abiding in this all-inclusive unborn oneness. Yes, I already know that I'm already abiding in this all-inclusive unborn oneness. And this is it. This is it. This is right here and now. And all of this, and this is right here, right now. This is right here, right now. And I already know this is right here, right now. This is right here and right now. And this really is happening. Yes. Okay. All right. Very great. I'm going to end the video now. That's it. Full stop in the wow.